We are rolling along in June. It's already June 5th, and we're getting close to the one-year mark where we'll have one more year left to prepare. Prepare for what? Prepare for the time, June 21st, 2016, after which point the world will conclude a general, it'll be a general consensus, crystallization of consensus at that point, that time is indeed about ready to start, and therefore we have to make final preparations at that time. And so the ideology will change then into what we might think as severity, as if it isn't already severe enough. It's you know, headed that way like a runaway freight train, like a train wreck. So about a year away. And you can certainly feel the pressure, and I'm certainly going as fast as possible. Now, there's a way to free ourselves from all the confusion in this world, and see it very simply as there's a division in this world between those who believe in time and those who don't believe in time. Even more so, there's a division between those who believe that time is going to start at some point, and those who realize there's no such thing as time, therefore it can never start. This in the Bible is talked about the difference between sheep and goats in the New Testament. The goats will try anything. They just, nothing seems to satisfy. They got to keep trying more and more stuff. This is emblem of those who are trying to get ready for time, because nothing, no identity, form identity satisfies them. So that they're always thinking, maybe this, maybe this. Let me eat this. Let me try this. I gotta get ready for time. What is existence? What is this universe? It's a simulation. What we're doing is we're imagining something we believe will be similar to time once it starts. Time hasn't started yet, okay? And it never will. It never will. So we are imagining what we believe would be similar to time, if it ever started, so that when we believe when it starts, we will be ready for it. Because see, in reality, there's no way to prepare for time to get ready for it, because time doesn't exist in reality. In reality, functions the way that it functions. There's no way to come across anything similar to time in reality. So what do? We dream, we imagine. We are imagining this in order to. It's like, let's say that we wanted to go somewhere and we couldn't go there. And so we go to sleep and we have a dream, and in that dream we see ourselves going there, you know, and as if the dream figure is getting used to going there will then help us get used to eventually going there, even though we can't get there right now. So this universe is a dreamlike simulation of our spiritual imagination, simulating something similar to what we believe time will be like once it starts. So that once it starts, we'll say, oh yeah, I've got a lot of experience with something very similar to this. So I don't have any continuity problem at all. I can just, you know, smoothly shift functioning, and now I'm functioning in the kingdom of time. The kicker is, of course, there's no such thing as time, and it will never start. So all this is useless. It's much ado about nothing. Okay. So in the world, we have these. If you look at the world, if you're looking at television, look at something, if you keep this in mind, that what they're doing is preparing for time to start. And then it suddenly, it makes sense. You say, wow, yeah. If you believe that time was going to start, this is what you'd be doing. It'd be following the logic of arrogance. It says, this is what we believe time is going to be like, and you got to do this and this and this and this and this, and this needs to be your mindset. And then also you realize that you can laugh at this, because you realize there's no such thing as time. And you're watching just this absurd farce. You know, people behaving so absurdly. And their reasoning capacity is just being trashed, you know? Because they're saying, well, hey, once time starts, all reason is out the window. I mean, time is going to be a tyrant. And so we'll just have to follow, you know, what it tells us to do. And reason won't matter at all. So they're being very unreasonable. And you can't seem to be able to reach them. And the stuff, the laws they're passing, everything they're doing is very, very unreasonable. And yet they don't care. They say, no, this is going to help us a lot. So they're just doing what they feel is going to help them out a lot once time starts. Problem being, time is never going to start. Okay, this is what they don't realize. Now, when you see it this way, it gives you a different perspective on everyone, and it's a very forgiving perspective, and you're less bothered by what's happening in the world. And this is quite an amazing perspective, and it's one that I feel that Jesus has in the times that I've been able to hang out with Jesus and talk with him in spirit. I was struck by his attitude, and it was such a relaxed, calm, no freak out, no concern, no worry, humorous, laughing. And I say, how can Jesus be this way? And the world is in such a terrible situation. There's people dying, sickness, all this stuff. What's going on? How can he be that way? And now I'm starting to realize this, that the attitude of Jesus. The attitude of Jesus is based on seeing the situation as it really is. And there's no concern at all. You see, because Jesus knows we're merely just pretending all this stuff. That just pretending. Nothing's happening to us at all. We're just pretending, dreaming as a simulation. And Jesus knows there is no time. It's never going to start. None of this matters at all. And nobody's in any danger of being lost in time at all. And no one's ever left reality. So he's very relaxed about the whole situation. Not concerned in the slightest bit. And I was wondering, Jesus, how in the world are you going to heal all this situation? And, you know, he wasn't concerned about it. He wasn't depressed. He wasn't. No, he just absolutely calmly happy and not worried in the slightest bit. So once we get this right perspective on what's taking place here, then this attitude can dawn upon us as well. Inevitably, it will dawn upon us. And this is what's most important, is when you spend time with those who we call enlightened beings, is their attitude. If their attitude is just, they're not bothered by you know, everything that's going on in this world. They realize it's of no consequence whatsoever. No one is even being touched by this at all. It's like they know who the dreamer is, so they know that the dream can't touch the dreamer, ever. And that this is just a silly dress rehearsal for what will never happen. That's all. And so they have absolute assurance that all is well, all is well, all is well. Absolute assurance of this. So they're not troubled in their mind at all. All these bodies being born and dying, those are just simulations of what we think is going to happen in the kingdom of time. That's never going to happen to us. See, it's never going to happen to us. We're never going to be born. We're never going to die. We're never going to be a body. And Jesus knows this. So he knows what we really are. And so and knows that this cannot be touched by any dream at all. So there's this great, perfect unconcern, not worried at all. And so when we can get this, start feeling this attitude, and this it starts permeating us, this, hey, you know, this, and so this is how we, you know, wake up from the dream, along with our right practicing. And that's what we're doing. And so what I'm finding is for the sake of a continuity of problem we have, let's find an easy way to do a soft landing into the perspective of changing the purpose for this dream. Since it's just a dream, we can change the purpose of the dream. Absolutely, we're the ones dreaming the dream. Everybody has their own universe, actually, of perception. So we can change our universe and say, universe, I've now decided I'm changing the purpose that you're serving, and you're now serving the purpose of preparing me for time not to start. Okay? And then whatever happens in that, you will just say, oh, okay, this is right in alignment with my purpose. Just no big deal, no big deal, right? We don't have to put it back into the old purpose. We don't have to integrate it back into the old purpose. When the miraculous starts happening, when we set everything free in our universe, now you're free to serve this new purpose. I set everything free, liberated in the now, released in the now, everything all released in the now. And be very specific. This, you know, this little pebble, you are absolutely just as free as this tree, as this ocean. It's just as important that you're free as everything else. You share the same freedom. You're absolutely liberated, released in the now, and your purpose is now to prepare me for the vision of time not starting, vision to prepare me for time not starting, for the realization of time not starting. So completely liberated from the old purpose. Every last bit of your universe, you can liberate it from the old purpose. Simply by, it's your decree, it's your call. It's your call. It's a dream universe anyway, right? So, and you dreamed it up, you get to make the call. And this is what Jesus tells us. We absolutely are completely sovereigns over our own experiencing. And so we can change the purpose of what we are perceiving. And it will change. Jesus says that when it changes, you won't believe how beautiful everything is. Paradise, absolute paradise, right here in this so-called world, you will be experiencing paradise wherever you are, because everything will be serving with great love and devotion and happiness and joy, serving the purpose that you've given it of preparing you for time not to start. Okay, everything will be that way. Now, I got, I have a little humorous anecdote here about that. I've been praying about this all day and liberating everything in my universe and to serve this new purpose, releasing it into the now, then release it into the now being the time not starting. And so I had to, there was something in my truck that I couldn't reach. I had to reach it. It was right in the middle. I was trying to reach over the bed. I couldn't reach it. I said, oh gosh, what am I going to do? How do I get that? I don't want to. And I was talking, I was liberating everything, the air, the breeze, you know, the sky, the sun. Everything is now liberated from the terrible old purpose that was supposed to, you know, help me get used to time starting. Now it's liberated from that. I free it from all that. And so I go back to the truck and say, well, now what am I going to do? And this item is now right over by the edge of the truck. I can just easily reach over and said, how the heck did that happen? And then I realized a gust of wind must have come and pushed it over so I could easily get it. Coincidence? Maybe, you know, but it's nice to think, like, you know, even the air will, you know, be your friend, that everything is now in this very wonderful friendly alignment with you. And this is what Jesus says we'll experience. And you know, it's been tough to believe him, because we can't figure out, well, how is that possible? Well, because we have liberated everything from the old purpose. We've set it free. And then it's hard to believe, well, how could someone be in the same world and that things don't work that way for them? And it does seem somewhat confusing, right? But It's the whole situation is such that it is possible. It is possible, even though we don't quite understand how it's possible. So Jesus tells us that everything will appear incredibly lovely to us. Equally, I mean, the sidewalk, the concrete. When I'm liberating everything, I'm liberating everything I see. Liberate everything you see. You're released in the now. Tile, you see tile. Tile, you're released in the now. Grout, you're released in the now. Steel, you're released in the now. Dead leaf, you're released in the now. I release you into the now. Into the now. Clump of dirt, I release you into the now. You know, piece of litter, piece of trash, I release all trash, I release you in the now. You're just as released as everything else. Don't make any exception for what you release. Absolutely release everything in your universe. The good, the bad, and the ugly. Because now it serves a different purpose. So it's holy. It's sacred now. Everything is sacred. Everything is holy. Everything is sacred. Because it's reminding you of your new purpose, which is to prepare for time not to start. Okay? Time not to start. And then ultimately, we will realize that there's no reason to prepare at all, because it is impossible for time to ever exist. So Jesus talks about the vision of Christ, the vision of holiness, the vision of oneness, the vision of sacredness, and we can have our entire universe appear this way to us, simply, but we have to set our universe free. We have to liberate it by decreeing, making a decision in your mind. Okay, this is now, I'm going to give the world, the universe, a new purpose. prepare me. This whole simulations are always for preparation. Okay, and reality doesn't need any simulation because there's no reason to prepare for anything there, because everything's completely natural there. But to prepare for something imagined, some imagined unnaturalness, a simulation is a preparation. So we're very familiar with simulation. Okay, so we don't want to just drop all simulation altogether. So just give simulation a different purpose. This is what Jesus recommends for us. Give simulation a different purpose. Now everything, this is a simulation that helps me prepare for the realization, time not starting. It's not going to start. The realization, it will never start. See, this is the realization we're going towards, an acceptance of this, full acceptance of this. Time will never start. Okay. Not that it'll start in a trillion years. It will never start. And this realization is very profound. So we need the universe to prepare us and support this realization. Be in support of this realization. Released in the now. You're now in support of this realization. I release everything. Everything liberated into the sacred support. Everything liberated into sacred support of this new purpose of realizing time will never start. Time not starting. Realization, time will never start. So Jesus might say, I am preparing you for the realization that time will never start. And here's how you go about it. Give the world a different purpose. So your experiencing will be the sacred support. The sacred support. That the very leaves and branches and trees will support you. The air will support you. The breeze, the atmosphere, the ground you walk on is supportive of you. The clothes you're wearing, everything around you is in total support that time of the realization that time will never start. This is the key to it. So I'm working on this. Keep affirming. So far, nothing has really dramatic has happened at all. But that's okay. You just have to ease into it. And so now we have a context to put this whole thing into. In other words, if we see that suddenly the world seems just incredibly beautiful and lovely, and without any exception, and it's all sacred, and you feel you're completely supported, and you're going to say, you're going to say, oh, okay, this is what I expected. This is because I liberated everything in the now. I released everything into the now, okay? And so that freed it up from its old purpose, and it's now serving this new purpose. So I did that. That was my decision. And so now I'm just experiencing the effects of this decision, and this is just helping me get used to this new purpose. And so Jesus, of course, he talks about Nicodemus when he went to the Jerusalem for the first time after he was baptized in the Jordan River. Nicodemus, he was talking to him. He told him, "Look, verily I tell you, that you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven until you're born again." And Nicodemus said, "Well, how can you be born again? Again, enter your mother's womb and be born a second time, right?" Well, what Jesus is talking about in being born again is choosing a different, giving a different purpose to the simulation. Okay. So instead of the simulation serving a purpose of preparing you for time to start, this simulation we call the universe is now preparing in sacred support of your realization that time will never start. Okay, this is the rebirth that Jesus is talking about. This is what he's talking about. So we've been like Nicodemus for a long time, haven't we? And now we're no longer Nicodemus. We're more like an apostle of Jesus now than Nicodemus, saying, "What are you talking about? Having to be born again? I just don't get that. I don't understand this." And it's like a new birth because everything has a different purpose, right? It's like the world is shining with this different purpose for you in sacred support. Sacred support. Whereas, previously everything was in support. You could call it sacred support, but it was in sacred support of your belief that time is going to start, and you need to be prepared for that. And the preparation is very harsh. And it's like time, the kingdom of time is, we feel like it's just going to be terrible. And yet we think that we have to get, that if we get familiar enough with how terrible it's going to be, then we can find a way to be happy in it. But now we have a different purpose, so it's like a different world. So isn't birth into a world? Okay, so when we give a different purpose to the universe, the world will seem as if we're in a different world. In other words, we've been born again into a new world. We've been born into a new world, even though physically our body is the same. It's still here, in this quote unquote this world. The world has an entirely different purpose now, and it will seem as if it's from the way that it. The sacredness of it will seem like, wow, this is like a different world. So this is like being born again. Except it's not the womb that gives birth to us this time. It's our decision. It's our decision. It's our decision. It's our mental, spiritual decision of how do we want to use this massive simulation, this massive dream that we have dreamed up, that we're imagining, that we're sustaining through our imagination, through spiritual will. But again, it's all symbolic. It's totally capricious. There's no such thing as time. So how can we have an accurate simulation of what the kingdom of time is going to be like? There's never going to be any kingdom of time. So it's actually completely capricious, completely arrogant, capricious. And so we absolutely can change it, change the purpose. There's nothing holding this dream, insisting that, you know, that this is the way it has to be. We can give it a different purpose. Like a symbol, does a symbol actually the thing that it stands for? No, it's not. So you can say, you know what, this symbol, I think I'm going to give a different definition of this symbol. It's going to stand for something else. We're absolutely free to do that. And there are those who have done that. Jesus is one of those who has done this. And so he knows that, yes, absolutely. He insists that we are absolute sovereigns, and when we make this change, the whole universe will rush in with great joy and delight, eager to serve our new purpose, eager to serve our new purpose, full of love and willingness, you know, and to serve our new purpose. So I'll say, okay, now universe, guess what? It's your fortunate day. You get to serve this new purpose, and the new purpose is to be in sacred support of preparing me for the realization that time will never start. Okay. And the whole, Jesus says, the entire universe will rejoice, as it were. You'll feel as if it's rejoicing. And everywhere you walk, he says that the universe rejoices that you're there. Wherever you seem to be, whatever you're doing, the whole universe is rejoicing in you. He says that is what you will experience. Because you've, quote unquote, set it free. You've liberated it from this awful prison, you know, having to simulate this hideousness for you, spirit, who absolutely loved the Son of God, and you've been, you know, asking this appearance simulate this hideous prison for you for so long, and now it's liberated, it's freed from that, and no longer has to simulate that for you. Now it simulates this glorious, beautiful freedom and happiness and protection and all of this. Keep in mind, everything that's happening here is just a dream simulation. So all the sickness and the attack and violence and troubles and everything, all of that is just a simulation that we're asking for. None of it is real at all. None of it is real. Now, again, when you get this perspective, you start looking at the world differently. And it's a much more forgiving outlook. And you see people, the way they act, and they say, oh, they're just preparing for time. Okay, that's their belief system. Okay. And then you say, oh, no worries. I know that you're going to give a different purpose to the simulation at some point. Easy for you, actually. Easy. See? Easy to escape this, actually. Nothing you're doing has any consequence upon what you are. It can never change your ability to make a decision to change the purpose of the simulation. It can never interfere with that. And so you're not so worried about people anymore. And this helps them, actually, because they'll say, why isn't that someone, gosh, you know, share my worry, concern, and everything, and then they seem so liberated from concern. You know, how is that possible? They start thinking about that. So I saw this guy who was just obviously, you could just tell his whole being, he's caught up in some very intense preparation for time, whether it's, you know, using drugs of different types, and you just feel the heaviness, the intensity and everything, the darkness of it all, you know. And he's walking by, he's looking at me, and I just say, hey, it's okay. I just felt like, it's okay. This is just someone that's preparing for very intensely for time, and they will also realize ultimately their power over this dream to give it a different purpose too. And then the world will rejoice with them and be in sacred support of them, just exactly the same it's in sacred support of Jesus while he was here. And any one of us that change the purpose for the universe will be in experience this sacred support. So it's not a lost soul. You realize there are no lost souls, actually. There's not one single lost soul anywhere. This is what Jesus knows. He's not concerned. I was wondering, like, Jesus, you know, you thinking, like, aren't you worried about these? There's some people that are, there's some soul spirits that are just hell-bent on self-destruction. And they, aren't you worried about that? No. All they're doing is asking the simulation to, you know, get very intense for them, believing that this is going to help them function in time. That's all they're doing. That's all they're doing. And this is how they're imagining time is going to be. This is the logic of arrogance. The logic of arrogance just goes in many, many complex directions because, of course, there isn't any time, so you can't be sure of how to prepare for it, can you? It's not like there used to be time, and so we know what time is like. There's never been time, so we don't know. We don't really know what it'd be like. So the logic of arrogance just pursues all these different avenues, and therefore, there's all this different variety and diversity of preparation for time to start. And we look at it and say, wow, you know, this is weird. How come is this? But when we see this perspective, it's not weird anymore. You say, oh, you just, you know, this is part, you know, this is part of the your effort to prepare for time. That's all. That's all it is. And so it flattens everything out. It absolutely flattens out. All your concerns just gets flattened out like this. That's always wondered. How can these liberated beings just, nothing seems to bother them? I mean, whatever weird situations, there's so many weird experiencing going on, simulations here of, you know, people are just so, you know, incredibly diverse and in weird in many different ways. And yet, that doesn't concern them the slightest bit. It's completely flat. Completely flat. They just, one judgment, they just realize this is just, they're just trying to prepare for time to start. That's all. That's all they're doing. That's all they're doing. Nothing other than that. And this is their way, what they think is going to be necessary. It's going to help them prepare for time. That's it. That's all there is to it. And so, see, their concern is just flattened out. They don't have any depth of concern at all. So they're just blissful. They're just calm. They're peaceful. They're blissful. The world does not disturb them. They're not bothered by it. Really, this world is just—it's just all these massive simulations, all different varieties, and that's all that it is. That's all that it is. So, there's no reason to see complexity where there isn't any. Actually, it's just one purpose it's serving, not many, just one. The logic of arrogance is very self-conflicting, and so it can go off in any and all directions, and go into very weird tangents, and just continually do this and do this and do this and do this and do this. It's never satisfied. Nothing's ever right. Nothing's ever enough. It's always hopeful that some modification this way or that way will work, and so you just have these just endless, you know, kaleidoscope of modifications constantly taking place, and yet it's all serving exactly the same purpose of trying to get ready to preparing for time to start, so they will feel like they have a niche in time, you know, be able to abide in the kingdom of time. And again, it's absolutely much ado about nothing. There will never be, time will never start. So we're just now making this segue into experiencing the sacred support of the universe for our realization that of time not starting. Time will never start. Never start. So we're making this transition into this. This is what's going on right now. So I'm trying to keep pace with this. So then when you start feeling this sacredness, you just say, okay, great. And this all I need to do is just get used to this. That's all. This is what's expected. This is what's entirely in line with the new purpose. Now, if you have holding on to the old purpose, then of course you have a freak out. You say, wait a minute, how can I integrate this into helping me? How does this help me prepare for time to start? So this is why we have trouble when we catch a glimpse of this sacredness support. It's only because for an instant we kind of wanted to reference reality again, you know, so we get a glimpse of it. We kind of like wonder, like, how are we doing? Is this simulation of time, is it really very different from reality? And so we'll allow ourselves a glimpse of reality, and then we'll say, oh my gosh, yeah, it's really, really different. Okay, and we'll say, okay, this must be working then. So we will have glimpses of reality occasionally. But when we do have those glimpses, just to kind of compare, you know, how the simulation, how intense it is, to judge its effectiveness, when we get the glimpse of reality, we'll say, wow, I really love reality. I wish I didn't have to do this simulation. I can't. I hate it. And so we get this longing. Say, I want to return back to my home. This simulation is horrible. But then we think, well, I got to soldier on. You know, I got to get ready for time to start. But still, it stays with you. Like, wow, I'd like to have another glimpse. You know, like that. But then we think, well, how can I integrate that glimpse? And you think, well, it's too difficult. I can't do that. And so we end up just with these little glimpses. But now that's not necessary, because we have a context where we don't need glimpses of reality just to compare the effectiveness of the simulation. We're no longer interested in the purpose of the simulation. So we can easily allow the sacredness, sacred support of our purpose now to prepare us to realize that time will never start. We can allow that all the time, continuous. We're not using it as a yardstick to measure the effectiveness of the simulation anymore. You see? So we don't have to integrate it. I know all this talk, it's just amazing, the world is how ignorant it is of this way, and it thinks that it has to integrate truth and lies. Like the best we can do is integrate this simulation for time to start with the reality that there's no such thing as time. So we have to like somehow have both, you know, that time that will never start, there's no such thing as time, but it'll never start, and it's also going to start. It does exist and it will start, and we have to be prepared for some sort of combination of that, you know, and so this has been held up as the highest goal in this world. Like, this is, if you're really advanced, you're going to have to integrate the two. And of course, this leads to some very, very dissatisfactory efforts. And so there's, you know, the ignorance of the way, the true way, is astonishing here. It's really astonishing. So we try all sorts of bizarre ways. The one that really traps us is the combined truth and lies. Let's have a combined simulation, one that supports both, gets us ready for time to start, and one that also gets us ready for time never to start. And somehow we have to be experiencing, you know, both of those simultaneously. And when we try to do that, we end up with this feeling like the world is completely chaotic. Our mind is totally chaotic. We don't know what anything is for. You know, it's terrible. So that way doesn't work at all. It's obviously ridiculous. So the door is wide open now for us. Wide open. Now that we see this, wow, okay. So sacred support can just simply arise now from everywhere. We're not making a single exception whatsoever. I mean, I'm giving this pebble in its concrete slab the exact same freedom and for liberating it into sacred support as I would give like the face of Half Dome or El Capitan in Yosemite or the Pacific Ocean or, you know, the Himalayan mountain range or the Taj Mahal or, you know, whatever, everything. I'm giving everything equal liberation, equal release into the now. It's all now given freedom to be in sacred support. All of it. So even just this one little pebble will be shining with this absolute gratitude towards you, you know. Everything. Just shining with gratitude and joy. Every leaf. Every bit of dust. Every bit of air. And you can actually absolutely have this attitude. I already have it. And you just walk around and everything you see, just, palm tree, liberated in the now. Hot dog wrapper, liberated in the now. Trash in the gutter, liberated in the now. Manhole cover, liberated in the now. Asphalt, asphalt street, liberated in the now. Grain of sand, liberated in the now. You see. Concrete slab, liberated in the now. Aluminum ladder, liberated in the now. Piece of wood, liberated in the now. Blade of grass, liberated in the now. Paint on the road, liberated in the now. And you're giving equal liberation to all of this, everything you're seeing. You're not holding it back saying, wait a minute, no paint, you can't be liberated. You have to keep serving the purpose of trying to prepare me for time. No, you're equally liberated, everything else, equal. Equal vision, sameness, vision of sameness, all liberated in the now. Stained glass window, liberated in the now. Light bulb, liberated in the now. And just have this feeling like everything around you is liberated in right now, liberated in the now. You've given it full permission, full decree that it is liberated now from your old purpose. Stands absolutely free of it right now. Not next week, not next month. Right now, it's liberated right now. And you can use whatever phrase you want for this, okay? However you want to say it, however you want to express it. There's not some magical expression that makes it so. It's not the words that make it so. It's your decision that makes it so. So however you want to express it is fine. However you want to assert is fine. Or even if you don't want to say anything, you just want to feel it. That's fine. But it often helps to say something to kind of get us feel that momentum. You know, dead tree, liberated in the now. Piece of stone, liberated in the now. Water in the creek, liberated in the now. released. Dust released into the released in the now, released in the now. Computer released in the now. Right, vase released in the now. Window released in the now. Wall released in the now. Desk released in the now. Headphones released in the now. So keep practicing this. Keep practicing this. It will dawn. It will dawn. I have a feeling it's going to dawn. This sacredness, sacred support is going to dawn. What's the dawning we're waiting for? It's this awareness of sacred support for our being. And this will be dawning means we begin to feel this, begin to be aware of it. Now, as Jesus tells us, we may, because out of our habit of believing in time, we may ask that it seem to delay itself as if it has to develop over time. You know, there's still tinges of supporting timeness there. Okay, but that's okay because we're in charge of this dream. So we can have this a sort of a smooth, gradually it dawns upon us sort of situation rather than just a sudden boom. Either way, actually, we're in support of the dream. We can have it either way. They talk about sudden enlightenment opposed to gradual. It's both, either way you want. You can have the sun, you can have it pitch dark and suddenly the sun is straight up in the sky and everything's, you know, completely light. Or you can have the sun rise in the sky and gradually go up, you know, and you can do it either way you want to. It's just all a dream. It has no ultimate consequence at all. And again, remember, this is just a simulation preparing us for time. So the fact that it may seem gradual dawns upon us doesn't mean that there is time. Doesn't mean that we, you know, try asking it. Doesn't mean we're trying to integrate it. Doesn't mean any of that stuff. It just means that we have a continuity fear so that we prefer it to kind of, you know, for the notion of time to, you know, the tinges to gradually recede and then slip away. You know, because we're a little jittery, think, oh my gosh, you know, what are we? Well, that's fine. What's fine? What's wrong with that? Nothing's wrong with that. There's no consequence to us whatsoever. We've been somewhat silly throughout history in our approach to this, actually. We've been kind of bumbling and fumbling a bit. Even among, it's right, all the practitioners of the past, all those who just like we're fumbling and bumbling a little bit here, that we've been fumbling and bumbling along with this because it's such a amazing truth to it. And so there's all sorts of philosophies and teachings and in the past that don't worry about any of that stuff. Don't worry about any of it. Jesus himself said, his apostles said, you don't really understand what I'm telling you at this point. He says, you don't get it. But eventually you will. Okay, so you just have to start working at it. But no, you're very dense, very, very confused, and you'll fumble and you'll bumble and you'll do this and that, but eventually you'll get it. It's the same. All throughout history. So it's not like we have to align this with history or align this with what in the past. No, not at all. Because most of those in the past were fumbling and bumbling. And of course, those who came to help needed to kind of reach them where they were at. And so they interpreted what they were being taught in a certain way and said, okay, this, I think this is what's being said. Even though that might not be, you know, they might not quite have it. And they think, well, this is what the teacher said. Well, the teacher oftentimes speaks at the level of the student, okay? And whereas now, if you really get it, the teacher's going to speak at a different, going to speak to you where you're at right now, which might be very, you know, very clearly. Whereas before, they would say something different. And some teachers, they say that they every single one they talk to, they would talk to them at their own level where they're at. And so when you compile that teacher's teachings, it might be very confusing. Because why you say, wait a minute, here you sound very dualistic, and here you sound very non-dualistic. And other times you seem to be mixing both of them, and it's very confusing. Very confusing. And these teachers do give a proviso. They say, hey, look, don't take my teachings personally, because I'm giving it out for each person differently. I'll say one thing to another, and I'll seem to contradict myself to someone else because they're, you know, able to handle the non-dual truth, or someone else is still in such a dualistic context or preparing for time context that I have to, you know, say what I say in a time context, so to speak, at least to get them going. You know, it's like that. So you have all this quandary in history. People say, well, the teacher said this, and someone says, no, they said that, and then there's all these disagreements, you know, between what they said. And so just realize that there is this ultimate truth, and all teachers are pointing to it. It's just that we were so fearful. We wanted to believe that the teacher was here to help us prepare for time so severely, we thought, because we're failing. We realize that we're not getting it. We're not really preparing for time properly. We feel insecure. We feel we don't really know. Is this really it? Why? Because there's never been time. There's nothing to compare it to. It's impossible. And so it's all just complete make-belief. And so how can complete make-belief feel certain that yeah, this is how time is going to be? There's no way to judge that. No way to judge it. So we think that these teachers know what time is going to be like, and so they're here to help us get ready for it. So we take whatever they say and put it into that context. We have a tendency to do that, which is, of course, the opposite of what they really are here to tell us. And so they have to work with us to gradually sort that out. So, of course, you're going to have all sorts of confusion, and it's a very rough, ragged road that we go upon as we try to clarify all this. We just need to forgive one another. Jesus said, love one another, knowing that they would have this problem. As we go along, we're going to have this problem. And there'll be some that say, no, this is what Jesus said. Others will say, no, Jesus said this. And there'll be conflicts and everything. And he says, just love one another here. Don't battle one another over your different interpretations. Because ultimately, there is this answer you will get to. Okay? And you will be born again into this universe of sacred support. And loving one another doesn't mean we force what we want upon others, or force our values on someone else. If someone else is using Jesus' teachings or using the world to prepare for time, they may demand that we help them do that, and that's, they're trying to force their values then upon us. You see, ultimately, there is no time. There is no way to prepare for time, and we have to give it up. So the path to changing the purpose of the simulation is a necessary path. There's no way you can avoid this. So there is a definite direction to the simulation, which goes towards changing the purpose of it. So it's not all just relative, or, you know, it. So there is a set of values that you can quote unquote are right, that move you in the right direction. There are values that help move you in the right direction. So those values should be emphasized. Absolutely, they should be emphasized. And the values that have to do with insisting that time is going to start and we have to prepare for it, those are delusional values, and these values should not be forced upon those who are preparing to change their purpose for the simulation. Should not be forced upon them. That's backwards, very backwards. We call it regressive, spiritually regressive. Okay, this is what's happening in the world right now. The world's in a very spiritually regressive situation right now. It's going into extreme darkness, spiritual darkness, which is the belief that time is going to start, and this is, there's no other, we're locked, the simulation is, we're locked into it. Okay, there's no way to change it. This is its purpose. There's this one purpose. There's no way to alter it. Therefore, and we don't want to alter it, and we are absolutely stuck here, and there's nothing we can do about it. This is going into like a dark tunnel, very, very, very dark tunnel, extreme darkness. And when we go into this extreme darkness, the people of darkness want to force their values upon the people of light, the people who are going on the sacred way. And then they say, no. We don't want that at all. We're through with that nonsense. We're not going to use this this simulation to help us prepare for time anymore. We're going to give a different purpose to it. So it may be how it's going to turn out, I'm not sure. But it may be that they're going to want a separate world for themselves, you know, where their values, they can wallow in these values, which are meaningless. You know, it's just delay, which are, you know, very hedonistic values, you might call it. Very goatish values, like goats eat anything. Sodom and Gomorrah values, basically, is what they're after, and they want to force these values upon everybody in society. And so then there's a lot of society that has left those behind. Okay, they've disciplined themselves. They realize that Jesus told us there is this remedy, challenged us to move towards this remedy, and they've put all, you know, they decided, no, we're going to make a decision, and we're not going to be that way anymore, of, you know, wallowing in the flesh. We're going to put severe restrictions on that. And so there's a clash of values in this world right now, and the laws are being changed right now to make it a criminal offense not to accept the values of darkness, really, of hedonistic delay. It's becoming criminal offense. More and more criminal offenses are being manufactured by those who want to wallow in this simulation for time as if it were, you know, totally essential, and that this gives inherent insecurity to them, which means they never feel satisfied. They're always searching for, you know, this is why the divorce rate is so high right now. It is just absolutely incredible. Some of the statistics right now are mind-blowing when you hear these statistics about people and what's going on in civilization in many places. You know, rampant divorce, you know, single family, so many single family, single parent families, but it just goes on and on and on, where people just feel like, wow, you know, grass is greener, I know that I'm not ready yet, and so this can't be it, I've got to find something else that's it. And so they're in this desperate search, and they want to feel like the law supports them, that they can do anything they want to do. And whereas a society that has advanced more towards liberation, they realize, hey, no, that's a severe waste of time. That's a drastic, very bad habits to get into. Very bad habits. Because we have to get our will to the point of clarity, so much so that we're able to liberate our entire universe, okay, into the now. So we'll experience sacred support for realizing that time will never start, and we have to do this. It's not an option. You see, this is what those who are using the simulation for time, they don't understand, that they don't have any choice. It's not an option to keep doing what they're doing forever. It's because time will never stop. Never start. It will never start. So everything they're doing is useless. It's futile. It's meaningless. And God did not create us for that. So we will inherently say, I cannot tolerate this anymore. So they should not be the ones who make the law here, who are setting the standards and the laws, etc. They absolutely should not be the ones doing that. They're blind leaders of the blind. They don't know. They think that they're in the right, that this is, they have to prepare for time because time is going to start. And they're in the wrong. They're mistaken about this. Absolutely mistaken about it. There's this bird that's hanging out right here, just listening to everything I say. Hi, bird. Nice to see you. Interesting. It's just watching me. Yeah. So it's not all, you and yet what's going to happen to this? I don't know. We'll find out. Pretty soon we'll recognize what's going on here and be able to make the right discernments. It's not a hospitable place for those who have made the efforts here. It's becoming more and more inhospitable at this level. Now, can we flip the script and again have the sacred support here in this world? I don't see any reason why not. Jesus said that he couldn't have been harmed at all if he didn't agree to it, you see. But on the other hand, I mean, is it that much fun trying to escape angry mobs all the time? I mean, didn't he go flee across the Sea of Galilee to get away from Herod Antipas, who was out after his head, and he had to go over there to the Tetrarch of Philip in Decapolis across the eastern on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee and hang out there. Where if Philip was not after him. I don't know. It doesn't seem like that much fun, really. Now, this world is really after, trying to eradicate the whole notion that somehow we can be liberated from this simulation or give it a different purpose. Because they feel that's their ruination. Because they say, well, that won't help me prepare for time, and once time starts, I won't know how to function, so I'll just go crazy. I won't know what to do. So they're dreadfully frightened, that there can be any pathway out of this, to freeing from this simulation. That seems to them to just be wrong, and they feel they should be able to do anything they want to do, anything they want to do. If it feels good, just do it. They feel that this is their right, inherent right. And they're just, of course, they're trying to feel somehow aligned with time, trying to align themselves with how the kingdom of time is going to function. And they can never get it right because there isn't any such kingdom of time. Everything is just totally make-believe, made up. Doesn't have this quality of certainty about it at all. So they're always uncertain. Always uncertain. And are chasing after certainty. And we've been going through this now for the last, 50, 60 years, massive promiscuity, massive drug use, and that just basically a massive materialism, massive changing of laws, massive changing of societies, massive social engineering. Massive immodesty, massive, coarseness, vulgarity, massive decadence, massive weirdness, depravity, on and on and on and on. This is just, society is just, rotting. Massive rot of society. Massive rot here. But now we understand they're frantic. They believe time is about ready to start. One of the great misconceptions about Jesus is that people think that he promised to come back and start time here. When he came back, then he would start time. And he'd be the ruler over time, the benign ruler over time, and would help all of us adjust to time. This is not why Jesus came in the first place. Jesus came to tell us there's no such thing as time. This is all simulation, that he will return at a certain moment in this dream to help liberate those who have done the work to who've ready for the rebirth and into giving this simulation a different purpose. That's what he's in support of. He's in support of helping us give us this simulation a different purpose. So he's not coming back to start time. In fact, he's already back, and he hasn't started time. He's already back. But because of this belief, the return of Jesus, and this is the time, certainly that's correct. He is back already. And if you interpret that meaning that he's going to start time, then everybody will have been frantically, who believe in time is going to start, they're going to be frantically getting ready for this. And this is what the last 50 years, this is what's been happening. Just look at the discotheque movement, in the was the 70s and 80s. I mean, wow. It's just so many people died from drugs. So many. I mean, there's this singer in New York, famous singer, this lady singer. She said, about half of her friends are dead? And died during that disco. So it was just, people were frantic, absolutely frantic. Going to those discotheques and just dancing all night long. Every night is a different costume, just taking mass amounts of drugs, sex, rock and roll, just partying like there's no tomorrow, just trying to get into that groove of time, trying to get into the groove of time. A lot of people didn't make it out alive, actually, of those times. The preparation was so frantic. And out of that came just sort of a general idea that all of society has to be changed to support this, that to allow anyone to do any sort of preparation they feel is necessary. Complete liberation of anyone, do anything, it's okay. Whatever you need to do to get ready for time, that's perfectly okay and allowable. And of course, those who are disciplining themselves to give a different purpose to this universe, they don't want to be distracted by that. Absolutely not. It's pulling them down back into the muck. It's very bad. Very bad. So we know what Jesus is about. I do know what Jesus is about. And Jesus is in support of us giving this different purpose to the simulation. So we will feel the sacred support of our realization that time will never start because it doesn't exist. This is Jesus's message to us. This is what Jesus supports. So when you're aligning with this and finding out about it, then you're getting in alignment with what Jesus is all about, what truth is all about, and how we can ultimately, we get free of all our suffering, all our misery, which is only a simulation. After all suffering is only a simulation, a dream. Believing that this is similar to what time's going to be like, so that's why we're dreaming this. Okay, we're going to be born, then we're going to have a body, then we're going to die, we're going to age and die. This is all a simulation of what we believe. We believe this is similar to what time, the kingdom of time, is going to be like once it starts. But it's never going to start. So we don't need these bodies at all, actually. We don't need, even if we have a body, we don't need aging. We don't need dying. We don't need any of this. It's all just a dream simulation of what we believe is similar to what the kingdom of time is going to be like. So of course Jesus can resurrect his body. What's the no big deal at all there, actually. It's easy. In one they're saying, Jesus, we want to see what was going to happen to spirit in the kingdom of time, and Jesus, and we want to have this play out. Oh, so the spirit's going to be crucified in the kingdom, tortured, murdered, crucified, in the kingdom of time. Okay, we get it. Okay. Thanks, Jesus, for showing us this. And then Jesus says, but guess what? You can give a different purpose to this simulation, all right? And you can have sacred support for your realization that time will never start. And you don't need a dead body. You don't need a crucified body, So here I am, see? Different purpose, born again, and with a different purpose for the simulation. There's the body. It's that simple. And they say, "Well, how is that possible? How did you break the laws of God's laws or something? What do you mean God's laws? This is a simulation of what something we believe is going to be similar to the kingdom of time once we believe it starts, but it's just completely symbolic. It's just imagination, fanciful thinking. There's no laws to it. It's not the laws of reality. They're not laws of reality at play here. We're still absolutely free, meaning we're free to give it a different purpose. We're free to set it down altogether or give it a different purpose. Either one. Continuity issue dictates to us pretty much that we need to give a different purpose. So there aren't any laws that are being broken in a dream. Symbolic dream that's meaningless dream. What laws are at play? Just all appearance, all a dreamlike appearance, based on trying to get us ready for kingdom of time, trying to get us familiar with it. They said, "We want all this. We want bodies to appear and age and die. All this, so we can feel that there's a familiarity with it. So spirit's familiar with this, and then when time starts, then we think, okay, I can feel familiar, comfortable with kingdom of time is going to be like." So Jesus is not back to start the kingdom of time. Okay, this is an erroneous misinterpretation of his mission. Understandable why we'd make this mistake, because we're so intensely trying to prepare for time, and so much believing if we don't, we'll be annihilated. Somehow we will be kicked out of the kingdom of time and into nothingness. So we're terrified, and anyone we see, we think they're there to help us prepare for time. Even Jesus said, no, that's not why I'm here. We still say, well, we're still going to use you that way. You know, we're still going to make sure to use you that way, or we're just going to reject you altogether, just ignore you. Say, oh, you're not the Messiah. You're not the Messiah. So some Jews accepted Jesus and said, ah. But some of those who accepted Jesus thought, oh, here he is, the Messiah. But he's preparing us for the start of time, and we have a special curriculum to prepare us for that. And we're on the advanced track, so we'll be more ready than anyone else. So they still misinterpreted. Another Jew said, no, forget it. And then Gentiles, same thing, all right? They said, no, he's not our Messiah. This isn't it. He's not going to set up the kingdom and rule over this world and wipe out our enemies and make us happy in the kingdom of time. We're just gonna have to wait longer. So some Christians thought that, you know, they were on the fast track to understanding the secret of how to abide in time, and Jesus was there to help with that. And then others, they began to get it a little better. Say, wait a minute, I don't think that's what he's here for. He's here to liberate us from this terrible, dreadful simulation. He knows the way to. He knows the way how to do that. And we have to keep listening to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will explain it to us. This is what Jesus told us, is listen to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will explain everything to you, and you'll eventually understand what I'm talking about. And that's all, you know, that we need to do is continually listen, let the Holy Spirit speak to us. And it happens as if the Holy Spirit will say, what if, you know, what would it be like if I thought this way? Or what about this perspective? What if I looked at it this way? And then you just decide to do that. And then you suddenly see it a little differently. Say, wow, I didn't see that before. That's the Holy Spirit at work. And they wanted to make Jesus a king, right? They said, Jesus, let's make you a king, and you're gonna rule over us, and you're going to be the benign ruler of time for us, you know. And he said, no. He had to flee away from those people. He'd jump in a boat and go across the Sea of Galilee. He'd get away from these people. They're demanding that he be king, put a crown on him. You know, they took him into Jerusalem was it Good Friday? Or was that Palm? Let me see. No, Palm Sunday, I believe. And Hosanna, Hosanna, here's the king. Here's the king of the Jews. Here's the king, you know. And we have our new king. He's going to rule over the kingdom here. And we won't suffer from time like the rest of people, because they don't have this benign ruler that's able to, you know, make everything wonderful for them. But it's not like that. It's not like that at all. Jesus tells us we have the power. It's our decision to liberate everything from the old purpose. Okay, of serving to simulate what we believe time will be like, to get us ready for time. We can liberate everything from that purpose in our universe, and now it has a different purpose, and it's sacred support. Absolute sacred support, where you then, this is if the entire universe is blessing you with great support, love, gratitude, joy. Now, I experienced this a while back, and I put it in a video where I had this student. What I've been tutoring, trying to raise them. It goes way back 30, 40 years ago, where I had a dream where I found this abandoned infant by the side of the road and nobody would claim it. So I ended up having to raise this infant. So I've been trying to tutor this, raise this infant up into adulthood. And I've been trying to teach it, and it couldn't understand, didn't seem to understand anything I was saying. I asked it for a final, you know, exam. I gave a final exam, and it turned in this exam paper to me, and it just didn't understand anything I've been saying. And I said, wow, that's terrible. And then I had some sort of realization that maybe it actually understood perfectly, or maybe it was just following what I was really saying to it, which was nonsense. And then I said, you know what, I'm going to set you free. You can go. You don't have to be under my care any longer. And then there was this amazing transformation where this entity or being or whatever it was that I was raising turned into this, you know, completely like a son of gratitude and joy towards me. Just the most, it had the most wonderful radiating to me, this incredible joy and gratitude towards me. I was just absolutely, I was in tears. I was just astonishing. And this was a precursor to liberating your universe, because we think the universe is, you know, still dumb, but it's just been doing what we told it to do. Okay. Exactly what we told it to do. And so we give it this exam. Have you really prepared us for time properly, universe? And you look at the results and you say, not at all. Fail. You know, of course it has to fail. There's no way to know. There's absolutely no way to know whether it's prepared us for time or not, because there's no such thing as time. And so it's just kind of like aimlessly wandering around. That's the exam paper I got back. It's just all this aimless wandering around from the student that I've been trying so hard to enlighten, you know. And then I realized maybe that's really exactly proper. It was actually faithfully doing exactly what I asked it to do. And so this universe has been faithfully doing exactly what we asked it to do. And then when we realize that, then we set it free. And then what comes back to us is this amazing gratitude and joy and love towards us. I've already experienced that. Oh, it was just extraordinary. This vision of Christ is the universe views you as Christ. The entire universe views you as the sacred Son of God, which is what we all are. And you know, just songs of praise, just to feel this praise towards you is just perfect, flawless praise. And unambiguous. It's not ambiguous in any way. It's pure, pure, pure. You feel this purity. This purity, absolute purity. So this is what we're headed towards. And we can take it in stride. Say, okay, this is now. I need to get used to this. That's all. I don't need to think about it. I don't need to think it's not. I just need to get used to it. And we gradually will. We gradually will. Just like somebody in a ghetto can gradually get out of the ghetto and get used to nicer housing. If you live in some hideous slum, gradually, you can gradually get used to better and better places. You can't just liberate someone from a slum and put them in this beautiful palace. And they'd be so shocked by it. You know, usually you need to have some steps, step by step by step. You know, a little better house, a little better place, a little better place. And gradually you get to better and better places, and where you feel comfortable saying, yeah, well, I'm comfortable in this very beautiful place. It feels natural, like home to me. Well, just like that, when this feeling of gratitude, the sacred support comes to us, you know, we'll get used to it step by step by step. So it's like dawning, it'll gradually dawn upon us. I remember that this experience I had, it was very intense, and I was just in tears, sobbing really, because I just the gratitude was just so strong. I didn't know what to. It was shocking, the gratitude that I had towards me. I've never experienced anything like it. Of course not. In this universe, have we ever experienced pure gratitude towards us? Never. Never. So it was a different experience. I had pure gratitude. I was feeling pure gratitude towards me. I said, what the heck did I do to deserve that? So this is what we'll be experiencing. Pure gratitude. Pure gratitude. From every stick we see, every twig we're walking along, every pebble we see, it will be expressing pure gratitude towards us. Wherever we go, This is a song of praise and gratitude will be directed to us. The garbage will all be singing our praises, equal to the majestic mountains, to a beautiful landscape. Yeah, that's right. The garbage in your kitchen will be singing the same praises to you as some majestically beautiful landscape or a gorgeous sunset. The barren concrete you're walking upon, the asphalt as you walk upon the road, will be singing your praises equal to the beautiful tile in some cathedral. All right? Equally singing your praises. You will be a pauper no more. Wherever you are, you're in the cathedral of praise. Never leave it. Entire universe will seem like one gigantic temple, cathedral, church, whatever, mosque, synagogue, ashram, etc., of praise for you. For you, towards you, praise for you. Joy, love, gratitude. Pure purity towards you, pure gratitude towards you. Wherever you go, just one vast place of worship, or place of gratitude, let's say, place of gratitude. One vast place of gratitude. That you set it free from this dreadful, dreadful purpose that you gave it. Trying to simulate time to you, trying to convince you of time. This is how time's going to be like. What a dreadful, dreadful purpose. And now you set it free. And I experienced this celebratory nature of this. The praise and gratitude and celebration was just so pure. I was taken aback by it. I I said, well, what did I do? What did I do? What did I do? Why? Why are you so grateful to me for? You know, what's going on here? So I've had to get up to speed on this, you know, and find out, you know, what's really going on here. Every dusty road, you know, every trail you walk upon, will be singing your praises and glory and gratitude and love towards you. And wherever you are, this will be the case. The stones will literally be singing your praises. All the rocks singing your praises. So grateful that you're there, and they can express their gratitude towards you, you know, for liberating them from this dreadful simulation to prepare for time. And then now they're in sacred support. They get to be in sacred support of you, your realization that time will never start. The waters, the streams will sing your praises, the stones, the grasses, the trees, the shrubs, the cactus, the succulents, vegetation, dirt, rocks, buildings, sky will sing your praises, the sun, planets, everything. All manufactured goods. That's why the teachers often bow, you know, and thank you. Thank you so much. And you say, why? Because the very walls, the very, wherever they are singing their praises. The very columns of the temple are singing their praises. You know. And so they're just like, wow, thank you so much for the gratitude and purity and praise and harmony that you're, you know, giving me. Just like they're just receiving all this. They're receiving all this. So they seem so appreciative all the time. So appreciative because they're feeling this, experiencing this praise, this sacred support. They're giving, they're experiencing this sacred support from everything, wherever they are. And so you come upon them and you think it has something to do with their interaction with bodies or something. And you come upon them, they'll just be sitting somewhere and you realize, wow, they're in the same state as they were before, and nothing seems to, they're always this way. You know, how is that possible? They're sitting up on the river, on a porch over the river Ganges, you know, and the whole river, you know, is singing their praises. The whole landscape is singing their praises. The whole terrace is. All the buildings are singing their praises. The very ground, the very earth is singing their praises. The telephone poles, the wires, everything. And they're just sitting there just enjoying it. And wherever they are, they're just enjoying all the praises, you know, the sacred support. This is the secret of it. It's not because you said something to them or you're worshiping them and that's it. They say, no, you're equal. You will have the same symphony of support as soon as you liberate, you know, your universe from the demand that it prepare you for time. Just liberate your universe from the demand that you're making upon it. Lift that demand off of your universe, and then the universe will praise you endlessly. Praise you endlessly because you've given it a different purpose now. It supports you in truth. Help you realize that time will never start. So it's very happy to do this. This is very, very joy, pure joy, pure gratitude, pure joy. And so we're no longer ignorant of this here. We're no longer ignorant of this here. And so it's a great time, quote-unquote time. I understand that's a conversational use of time. Right now to get this, be informed about this. Because the alternative is so terrible, actually. So it's actually a great opportunity we have now. It's a great opportunity we have now. Because the alternative is so terrible. And they say, doggone it. If only the alternative wasn't so terrible, maybe I could just take it easy. But no, we don't have that option right now. It's the way the world is going towards is they're cracking down. They're cracking the whip. And they're saying everybody must support this, insist upon this simulation for time. You know, this is a demand. We are demanding this of everyone. One world dictatorship, you know, the kind of thing that everybody must be on the same page. This universe exists to support our preparation for time to start. And it's set in stone. God set it in stone this way. And this is what it has to be for. There's no way to change this. And this, of course, is just, you know, delusion. So we're certainly under the gun of these times. But that's turn it into a positive. You got lemons, make lemonade. Absolutely. Do not get crushed by this. Just say, okay, the information is filtering out. Just say, hey. Just let yourself realize that there are teachers, there are those who know the truth. For example, Jesus is one of those. So these teachers have been working with their students, helping them realize the truth. These students are speaking out. I'm certainly one of those students. I'm speaking out and explaining. I say, this is the truth. This is true. Okay. You're not stuck. You can change the purpose of your universe, your universe. And so this information is filtering out to you. It is getting filtering out to you. You're not in ignorance anymore. You do have this tool. You do have this awareness. You're not stuck. You're not going. You don't have to be dragged down into this terrible future here of how they're trying to, you know, how they're trying to make it, where it's totally illegal to even think about using the world, this simulation, give it a different purpose. Totally illegal. Punishable by death, is that's what they're aiming for. They're absolutely aiming for that. Keep in mind that the early Christianity, and many times throughout history around the world, to be a Christian, it was punishable by death. Punishable by death. Still is many places, isn't it? The Book of Martyrs, if you look at the Book of Martyrs, it's extraordinary how many Christians have been killed in this world. It's not, you know, not permissible to have a different belief about this, you know, the purpose of this universe. And so the world absolutely is trying to get back into putting to death whoever dares to suggest that you can give this universe a different purpose. And so they want to eradicate, you know, the truth here. And again, they're just frantically frightened and thinking that they have to get ready for time, because time's just about ready to start. It could be any day now, they're saying. Any day. Any day they think that time is suddenly going to start without a warning. Like a thief in the night, it will suddenly start. And that they might not be ready. This is everybody's insecurity here. And this is materialism plays off this insecurity. The politicians play off this insecurity. They think any day could start, and I'm just not quite ready. It's impossible to feel ready for time. It's impossible. Nobody can. Nobody knows what time will be like, because it's never existed and never will. So we're just fantasizing what we think it's like, but we don't have any sure conviction at all. Nobody can feel certain that they're ready for time. Nobody. It's impossible. So beneath their braggadocio in front, you know, everyone's very insecure about this issue. That's why demagogues can arise and sway people this way, sway them this way, sway them this way, because they play upon this insecurity and uncertainty, and the demagogue says, "I know the way. I know what's it. You know, I know how to help prepare for time. You know, don't worry. I will. You just follow me, and I'll set you straight about it." And the people, being inherently insecure, are vulnerable to that always, 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 always. And we wonder, how is this possible? We've allowed the world to sink into demagoguery that is present right now, because we have this terrible vulnerability of uncertainty, you know, insecurity. We don't know. Nobody knows what time is like, because it has never existed, never will. How can we know what time is like then? This is all just a make-believe simulation, just made it up. So how can we know that we're really preparing for time? How can we know? We can't. We can't know whether what we're doing is right or not in terms of preparation. There's no way of knowing this. So of course, it's like a house of cards. It's like a house of cards. The demagogue will come along and say, don't worry. I'll make sure the house of cards doesn't fall down. You know, demagogue will say, I know it's a house of cards, but guess what? You just empower me, and I'll make sure the house of cards doesn't come down. And people say, okay, oh, great. But Jesus is not a demagogue. Jesus actually knows the way to give a different purpose to the simulation, where we don't feel then the insecurity, because we're not preparing for time anymore. We're preparing for reality, and we know what reality's like because we have abided in reality, you know, from our creation. So actually we do have this memory, so to speak, of reality, and reality is real. We do know what it's like, and so it's therefore we have this sense of certainty grows within us. Oh, I know I am properly preparing for reality. Whereas with the simulation for time, we can never know if we're properly preparing for time. There's no way of ascertaining this whatsoever. We're just assuming, everybody's just assuming, and sort of a collective assumption that this is it. This is why you have so much diversity throughout the cosmos, is so many different ways that they assume, well, this is it, this is how you prepare for time, and this is it. And then different groups in the cosmos meet one another, and then they say, wait a minute, we thought this is it. And they said, no, we thought this way. And they say, well, why don't we integrate the two ways, and maybe that will be it. And then they come to some agreement and gradually try to integrate, you know, and nobody knows. It's unknowable. It's unknowable. You cannot answer the question, how do I prepare for time? There's no such thing as time. You can never know the answer to that question. It's impossible to know it. And that's the question everybody's asking, you know. Hey, do you know how to prepare for time? And you got to say, it's an unanswerable question. Since time will never start, there's no such thing as time, there will never be a kingdom of time, there will be absolutely nothing by which to gauge your success or failure of how to prepare for it. So you cannot pass any judgment at all upon this attempt. Therefore, all we can do is give a different purpose to this simulation. All right. It's only important that we lean a little bit more. We lean towards accepting, like, okay, yeah, there is this way. We can give it a different purpose. That is the way. We can be born again. This is the challenge. I'm going to accept the challenge. It's enough to lean that way, all right? for some very positive dispensation to take place. I would say you're a sheep and not a goat. And basically you say, okay, yeah, I accept this. You just accept it in your heart, your mind. Accept it in your mind, in your spirit, and say, okay, yeah, I hear it, I know it's true. Okay, I'm going to go in that direction. This is what my efforts are going to be aligned with. And that should be enough to get you past this situation in the world, I would think, in some way. You know, who knows what's going to happen? Are you going to be relocated to some other place? Are others going to be relocated? How is it going to take place? Are you going to have a... whatever. I don't know, but it's not like you have to be perfect. You just have to lean that way and decide, okay, this is the direction. It's just a direction. You turn in the right direction, you say, and you start walking and say, okay, you know, this may take a while, but I know this is the right direction. And I'm gonna, you know, walk this direction, go this direction. And you don't need to keep figuring out the ways of those who are trying to prepare for time. Now you know what they're doing. You don't have to catalog all the different ways they're trying to prepare. It's completely unnecessary. The bottom line is just they're preparing for time to start. That's it. You don't have to judge it, give any further thought to what they're doing, really. That's why Jesus, he seems so untroubled. I said, you know, he doesn't need to give any thought. He just knows, okay, these ones are still trying to, you know, prepare for time. That's all. That's it. You don't have to evaluate all the different ways as if somehow there's some difference among them all. There's no difference. They're all pursuing the same objective. It's all equally futile. So what is the difference? There's no meaningful difference at all among any of it. Any of these efforts to prepare for time, they're really equally meaningless. They're just aimless wandering around. So there's no reason to try and catalog and organize and think about all the different, you know, ways that they're trying to go about this. It doesn't really matter. Answer still the same. We liberate, release, concrete released in the now, building released in the now, hills released in the now, bridge released in the now, vineyards released in the now. Whatever you see, you know, released in the now. You can release your universe, from the purpose that you gave it. Into this sacred support for really right nowness, you know, no timeness, right? So it's in support of the now. Book released in the now. Words released in the now. Concepts released in the now. Bodies released in the now. Personalities released in the now. Structure released in the now. And then that sacred support makes it possible for you to do, you know, all sorts of stuff to help out, to bear witness to its support of you. And we have a lot of historic records of miracles of somebody teaching somewhere, and then the next day they've traveled 800 miles or somebody on foot or somewhere else. They find out later, you know, by courier or something, that, oh yeah, the teacher appeared on this particular day at our monastery or whatever. And they said, what are you talking about? He was here on this day, the day before, at this place. It's 800 miles by foot. What do you mean? How could it be impossible? No, just So the universe enables, sacred support enables the witnessing of this support to do things that we would say is miraculous, actually. Bilocation is one of them, all sorts of stuff. But we don't have to even think about that or worry about it. The main thing is to just get used to this overall shift here, rebirth. And ultimately, it'll dawn, and we'll grow in comfort with it. You know, I'm not looking to try and do anything exceptional at all. Just get used to it. That's all. Some of those who have gotten very, very used to it, then they seem to exhibit, you know, certain miraculous behaviors in various ways. But that's not really, you know, the central part of it. It's just get used to it. That's all. It's a lot to get used to. We're so used to this world seeming like some harsh adversary, universe, you know, harsh adversary of us. And now to feel that its only purpose is to make you feel, you know, perfectly safe and loved and gratitude towards you and all this. That's a big change. That's a big change. And so you know now why people suffer harsh conditions and suffering and tragedy. That's their way of trying to get ready for time. That's all. The logic of arrogance is following the logic of arrogance. It wants to prepare for time, and it may decide, hey, okay, this simulation is going to now have a body be born into this world, and then have the body die early, the age of like 2 years old, through some disease, and then it's thought, it's believed that this will help get ready for time, because this is what time's going to be like. This is part of the kingdom of time, will be like that. That's what they believe. And so they'll believe in all sorts of, you know, tragic circumstances and victim circumstances and all this stuff. But they're just, this is all simulation that the logic of arrogance is presenting to spirit. All this, the logic of arrogance is presenting this to spirit as if the logic of arrogance was some sort of God, you know, that is providing all this. It's only our own imagination, actually. It's not God. It's our own imagination run through this logic, this premise. This basic premise that time is going to start. And then from there, then this logic seems to have a life of its own, like some power of its own. That so we think it's like a God that is causing all this experiencing here, this simulation. But it's really our own imagination that's doing it. We're simulating what the God of time is going to be like. Right, but it's just our own arrogance that's doing this. It's not actually time; it doesn't exist. It's just our own arrogance, and we believe that, you know, God has made this universe and bodies and all circumstance. God is causing all these circumstances to take place, and none of that is true. It's our own arrogance that's doing all of this, in an attempt to get spirit ready for the start of time. And of course, spirit's trying to play God, the prime creator, saying, I created this new kingdom, the kingdom of time. Separate from God's creation, you know. Spirit's trying to be prime creator. That's the original whimsical adventure. We're almost at the longest day of the year. It's crept right up on us, hasn't it? That's too bad. But now, when we choose, give a different purpose to the simulation, what I've been told by those who've done this, is that there's light Everything is light, is lit up. There's no such thing as darkness. So the nighttime, when everything here, when everything turns dark, they don't experience any darkness at all. Everything is just as bright as a daylight. Hello, bird. How are you? It's a nice little bird, friendly bird. It's just kind of hanging out here a lot. That's the one the blue jay attacked. It's a very modest bird, just a dowdy brown feathered bird. Whereas the blue jay was very strikingly arrayed, you know. It's hello, bird. Like a monotone bird. Someone look at it and say, ah, has no bright plumage at all. It's not attractive. So that, yeah, everything will. And so this one, there's been testimony of this, and you can blindfold people like this, and doesn't matter. They say that I'm not even using my eyes to see at all. I'm seeing spiritually. I see everything spiritually. This is how the universe works for me now. The body senses don't limit me in any way. The solar light, electromagnetic light, doesn't limit me in any way. What you're experiencing, I'm experiencing something different, you see, different purpose. They may not get fatigued, they may not need to sleep, they may not need to eat. It's not necessary. The universe is directly supporting their presence here. Sacred support, absolute sacred support. That's why Jesus said, you couldn't harm me at all if I didn't agree to it. It's impossible. The entire universe is supporting me and keeping me safe, and every hair in my head, you know, really, literally. And again, it's a simulation. This universe is a simulation. So those who are asking the simulation to prepare them from time won't be able to see the simulation that is supporting us in the recognition that time will never start. They'll be oblivious to it, you know. And so they think it's a miracle. How's that possible? It's not possible. What do you mean? You know, what are you talking about? It's pitch dark here. I can't see anything. That's what they're asking for. Again, a simulation being a dream, all imagination. You see, this is possible to have different simulations, and someone that would be unaware of what you're actually experiencing. And the universe will know where to go, where to go to help bear witness to this truth. And so you'll feel like you're guided in perfect safety at all times to share the witnessing, something like that. So, yeah. So, time to get it going. Time, quote-unquote time, conversational time to get it going, because the demands of this world now are becoming extremely dictatorial and harsh, as we know. That you have to accept the values of those who are using a simulation to prepare for time. They think that's the only simulation possible, and you have to then agree, you know, go get fully in sync with that legally. They're demanding legally you have to be completely in sync with that. Jesus has returned here already, and so is working to freshen up our understanding. And this is part of the Jesus outreach. Jesus has an outreach going on. This is part of it. This video YouTube channel is part of that, explaining to you what's really going on, so you can shake off the cobwebs, shake the dust off your feet, get the rust off, you know, and remember, oh yeah, that I remember that. That's what I'm aiming at, actually. Give this simulation a different purpose. Liberate the simulation from my demand that it prepare me for time, and now place this blessing upon it, that it now prepares me to realize that time will never start. That's a blessing. And now it'll serve this blessing towards you. Say, oh yeah, now I remember. Yeah, that's right. Okay. So, there is this outreach taking place right now. It will continue. And I don't have in advance, I don't know exactly how it's going to go, but, you know, it's going. It's going. You know, and each step we take, we get used to it. Each step we take, we get used to it. The more we get used to it, the bigger steps we can take. It's like that. Now, we may think we need some great teacher to come to our doorstep and acknowledge in gratitude. No, it will be the very stones and the asphalt and the sidewalk and the sky and the walls and the vegetation and everything that will be singing our praises. The fruit on our kitchen counter, the coffee maker, the oven, the microwave, the grill, will be singing our praises. The formica, the laminate, the carpet, the drapes will be singing your praises. The vegetable peels, you know, that you peel, the garbage will be singing your praises. The dustpan will sing your praises. The broom, the water heater, the patio, the cobblestones, your doorstep, the doormat will sing your praises. Your bike, your car, your truck, your vehicle will sing your praises. The wheels will sing your praises. The road will sing your praises. The clouds will sing your praises. The rain will sing your praises. The sunlight will sing your praises. The birds will sing your praises. The bees will sing your praises. The pots will sing your praises. The cardboard will sing your praises. Everything will. The wastebasket will sing your praises. The wires, the cables, the plastic will sing your praises. The pine cones will sing your praises. The leaves will sing your praises. Hello, bird. Hi, bird. The little bird is keeping me company now. Maybe it has a nest around here somewhere. It's just hopping all over the place. That's nice. The water will sing your praises. You know, the refrigerator will sing your praises. You open up the refrigerator and the milk will sing your praises. The pickles will sing your praises. The ketchup will sing your praises. The food you eat will sing your praises. The plate, the silverware will sing your praises. The salt will sing your praises. The pepper will sing your praises. The herbs will sing your praises. The closet will sing your praises. The clothes will sing your praises. Your shoes will sing your praises. The socks will sing your praises. The shampoo will sing your praises. The towel will sing your praises. The toothpaste will sing your praises. The porcelain will sing your praises. The tile will sing your praises. The wallpaper will sing your praises. The sheetrock will sing your praises. This wood studs will sing your praises. The nails will sing your praises. The air will sing your praises. Yeah. So, we don't need some teacher to knock on our door or to sing our praises. We don't need a caroling group, a Christmas caroling group come by your door. We're going to sing you a song. We're going to sing your praises. No, it is the whole universe will be singing your praises. like a symphony, great symphony of praise. Ongoing, fluid, you know, see, there's nothing that can be put into a musical composition, artistic composition, nothing like this, because it's the totality of it and the nowness of it that's important, and the gratitude of it, you see. You cannot turn into a stale, you know, work of art. That's ridiculous. You know, we've been there, done that, tried that. You know, that's nonsense. It doesn't work. That's not what we're after. That's still trying to use it to get ready for time. You know, that's not it at all. Every pine needle will have a note of praise for you. Every pine needle will have a note of praise. The whole universe will be humming with praise for you. The collective hum of the praise, some people call it the om, om, or this hum, you know, it. But there's both this collective noise, like at a baseball game, like you listen to the crowd, everyone's talking in the crowd, talking with one another, you see that, and there's this hum, a buzz, they call it a buzz, a hum, like a hive of bees or a swarm of bees. You hear the overall hum, right? But also, each individual bee, the sounds of their wings, is producing its own hum. And every wing, every bee is producing a slightly different, you know, vibratory sound, right? So there's both the individual sound of the bee's wings and then the collective sound of the swarm. So the universe might seem like there's this great, fast hum of praise towards you. But also, every last little thing has a delicate note. Every little leaf, every, you know, everything has a note of gratitude and praise for you. And of course, people ask, well, once time starts, what will it be like? Time's never going to start, right? So that's a ridiculous question. See, what those who want to get ready for time, what they're trying to do is they say, well, give us some sort of simulation of reality so we can get used to then not getting used to it, blocking it, saying, oh, that's not so important. So give us something that's similar to reality so we can then compare how well we're doing to get free, you know, free of it. That's ridiculous. Don't engage in that. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of quote unquote. It's a delay. It's a delay. It's a delaying tactic. And they also want to be fortified. They're ready to dive deeper into preparation for time. They might want a sort of a little feeling of reality just to fortify them. You know, to say, give them some will, and then turn that momentum then towards another push into darkness, that kind of thing. So, So it's possible you could hear this vast, vast symphony of gratitude towards you, like a vast hum coming from the whole universe. Gentle hum. And also, at the same time, be experiencing gratitude coming from various places, like this plant, you know, and this leaf, and this mat, and this area, you know, you could experience it. All of that richness, vast variety of richness. And maybe when you tune your attention, you can hear specific notes coming from various places, specific expressions. And in the background, the hum will still be there. Something along those lines. I experienced it once, the called the music of the spheres. I experienced this. Everything in the whole universe had a note. The mountains, the rocks were all singing to me with notes, tones, pure tones. And it was this vast symphony that was taking place with, you know, infinite instruments, pure, never, and no need for me to conduct it. It was conducting itself. I didn't need to compose anything. I was just, you know, now I was no longer the composer, now I was the audience. And I was just experiencing this. That was an extreme wow moment, but now I'm sort of recognized what the basis for all that is. So we need to experience the sacred support. That's the new purpose we have. Experience the sacred support. So like an audience member, there's this vast symphony of gratitude, and just, you know, you're just experiencing that support, saying, wow, this is great. Okay, so maybe that's enough for now. Okay, I think it is. Give us something to consider here going forward. All right, very great. That's it.